And now, a word from
Infirmary Media.
Hey dudes and dudettes, thanks for tuning into this episode of the Be Kind and Rewind podcast, a podcast chock full of everything that is nostalgic about the 80s, 90s, and more, where we chat with our favorite celebrities about our nostalgic VHS days. I'm your host, Carlos, and this episode, I'm joined by a talented woman who's performed in many iconic TV series, movies, and Broadway productions like Grease, Mork and Mindy, Three's Company with Mr. Belvedere, and more, along with the 90s classic Ladybugs, and she's also a decorated recording artist and author of a parenting book. So I welcome actress, author, and Grammy nominated recording artist Ilene Graff to the podcast.
Hello, podcast.
Hello, hello. Thank you so much for taking the time. I really appreciate it.
My pleasure.
So yeah, so not only was I excited to have you on as a guest, but my wife as well. She is a huge Heart of Dixie fan.
Oh.
She claimed that she has watched it 4 times over, so she knows all the details. She's okay. Like, just tell her I said hello. She couldn't come up with a question, but she at least wanted to say hello and show her appreciation for your work on that show. You get to work with some other iconic TV actors like Tim Matheson, Regina Bell Johnson, John Marshall Jones. You guys all get to get sprinkled in there throughout the show.
Yeah, I worked with Tim, but I didn't work with the others. You know, it just depends on who's in your episode. But Tim, in addition to being an actor, is a director, and he directed one of the episodes of Heart of Dixie that I did, and he's a really good director.
Well, awesome. Yeah, and like I said, she loves the show. She's like, don't try to get too much into it. I don't want to break the magic of the TV series. I'm like, it's okay. We'll try to keep it vague. But yes, like I said, she enjoys the show. I haven't watched a crazy amount of it, but I definitely love the intro. So every time I hear the intro, I do a little dance song and dance for her. It's so catchy. So, and of course, I walk.
You're such a good husband to do a song and dance.
And she catches me up on the plot lines. And when I walk through the room, I'm like, wait a second, what's happening now? She's like,
what's
she'll
happening?
Catch me up. Yeah, she'll what catch me
do?
Up. So,
why do they like him? I thought he liked her. I thought she liked him. Yeah,
exactly. I technically have seen the show through her at this point. Uh-huh. So, yeah. So, like I said, we're definitely excited to have you on and just to kind of get into things, you know, doing some research. Of course, you're originally from Queens, New York, where you started performing as a teenager, following a growing line of performers in your family, including your father, Jerry Graff, who was well known for his vocal groups, the Beachcombers, during the Rat Pack era, including with Frank Sinatra's group, Pied Pipers, and Nat King Cole and others. Like, so tell us about growing up with a father in the industry and maybe some memorable experience you learned from those opportunities.
Well, you know, when you grow up in your family, you just think that that's normal. So I didn't think anything of growing up half the year in Las Vegas and half the year in New York. That's what we did.
Every kid does that, right?
Yeah, you know. Every kid does that. So it was really kind of normal for us. I mean, most people didn't do what we did when I was growing up, but we had a very kind of normal, if eccentric, life when I was a small child. I learned a lot. I mean, I spent a lot of time backstage with my dad in Vegas watching Lena Horne and Nat Cole. And one of my fondest memories of my young childhood in Las Vegas was whenever Frank Sinatra would be playing the Sands, my dad's act, the Beachcombers, often was in the show. They used to do like production shows and then with production numbers leading up to the headliner, and the headliner would do most of the show. So my dad's group did lots and lots of those. And whenever Sinatra was on the bill, he would take me, like as a 7-year-old or an 8-year-old, we would go sit in the light booth, you know, where the follow spot was, and we would watch Frank Sinatra's show. And I think that was really formative for me to be able to be that close. I mean, not on the stage with him, but from a very young age to be aware that this man, whoever this Frank Sinatra man was very special, that the whole town just was swinging whenever Sinatra was around, you know?
Of course. Well, I'm sure with your family lineage and performing and then having those experiences, it wasn't hard for you to, you know, get inspired to get into performing, I'm sure, right?
Yeah, I started working a little bit as a young teenager, again for my dad, who was by then a studio singer in New York, you know, singing on jingles and backup stuff on records. So he would have me in to sing whenever they needed, like, a teenager or a children's chorus or something like that. And then when I was in, you know, transitioning from senior year of high school into college, I started thinking seriously about theater. And by the time I got to college, the first couple of weeks, I said, no, I think I want to be a theater major because I loved musicals. And I had been, my first musical wasn't until my senior year of high school, but it was profound to do that. And it was something that I could see myself doing for real. So when I had the opportunity to major in drama at college, I said, I think this is what I'm going to do and see where it leads me. But I never had serious aspirations to do pretty much anything that didn't involve singing or acting. For a while, I thought maybe I would be a doctor or whatever. But when you're really no good at math, it's hard to pursue one of those other.
Oh, don't I know it?
Yeah.
So yeah, well, like you said, like getting into it wasn't, you know, it wasn't that hard of a decision, but like going through that type of time of your life, anyone can relate. You're not really sure what you want to do. You think you're making the right decision, but you're still not sure. You're always kind of second guessing yourself, but then once you kind of get into it, you kind of find yourself in that experience. And kind of going back to getting into it as well, did you give yourself any like personal or external pressure? Can you know, live up to any expectations, especially with your father or the family at all?
Not at all. It felt very natural to me. I never really questioned whether I was going to have a career. I just assumed I would because I grew up in a world where everybody around me, all the grown-ups, had careers. I didn't know that some people failed. I didn't know that. It wasn't part of my reality. Because when you're in a situation where all of your parents' friends are in show business and they all work, you don't know people that don't work. So you don't know that it's an option to fail. So I just assumed that I would continue doing what I wanted to do. And it wasn't until much later, after I was a professional, that I realized, wow, not everybody can make a living doing this. And that's when I sort of took a moment and said, you better be grateful for this because this is rare. This is not something that just happens for most people the way it kind of just happened for me.
Yeah, like you said, it was just kind of, it's one of those things, you know, you kind of wonder if it's better off that you didn't know that stuff, so you don't have that, maybe that expectation or that connotation that can come with it when people say they want to become actors or they want to become performers, and people know, well, you know, it's always the first excuse is, well, not very many people make it. Like that's usually the first line that comes out of people's mouths whenever people express that they want to be a performer. Like, well, not many people make it. And so, but I think you know, it worked either way. You know, and for you to find out later, it worked out because I mean, you had the talent and everything that goes along with it. And so, I don't think is something you would have ever had to worry about.
Well, that's very sweet of you. Yeah, I didn't start having a problem getting work until I got older, you know, past my 40s. And we all know statistically that the number of jobs available for older performers are not that many. So that's when things started to become challenging. But I must say, for the first 25 years of my career, things were pretty smooth. So I was very, very lucky.
Well, great. Wait, well, then, so like after getting into the, you know, into some of the commercials and into after college, you made your way onto New York's famous Broadway scene, you know, with some roles in Promises, Promises, I Love My Wife, and as Sandy in Grease, which, you know, congratulations. That's awesome to land all those roles. So did the hype and mythology of the feeling of making it to Broadway, did it live up to those expectations?
Yeah, it was great. And again, I have to say, getting that first job, my first job was Promises, Promises out of college. I was off doing summer stock right after graduation and then auditioned for Promises and got it. And I was just out of school for a few weeks. And coming to New York and being in the show was thrilling because it was, you know, it's the fulfillment of what you study for. it's, you know, you go to school and you take lessons and you take classes and you do all that stuff in the hopes that you're going to get a job. And that one came along and it was a great first job. And it was very exciting being with people who did the same work that I wanted to do and that I found myself doing. So I felt like I sort of just slipped right in there and I felt like I belonged in a way. I just felt like I had found my people.
Well, I mean, there's no better way to get introduced to the New York scene by being on Broadway and then having to, you know, get to experience all the things that go along with that, like the, you know, the after parties, the friends, the different types of experience that go along with that. I mean, that's just, you know, on top of a lot of people's, you know, wish list, I imagine. And so, and like you said, you got to experience firsthand, which is amazing. So were there any, like, what were some pros and cons that maybe you didn't expect when you began to perform, like, on Broadway?
Well, I didn't know that I was going to be making such lifelong friends. There are friends that I made my very first day and my very first Broadway show that I'm still very close to. And I didn't realize that that kind of bonding was going to happen. And, the Grease friends, you know, I spent 2.5 years in Grease on Broadway, and the group of people that I did the show with through those years, we're still very close. We still see each other. And I didn't know, and I love my wife cast, you know, I can depend on them if I need them for anything. I didn't know that that was going to be such a big part of the experience. And it's very, very precious because they're very impressive people. They're very talented, but they have such big hearts. And to know that you've got so many people that you met when you were so young to have friendships that have lasted 40 plus years is such a bonus from being in that world. The minuses, I think, were far fewer than the pluses. It's just picky little things. Like when you're doing a Broadway show, you work when everybody else is off. So I never had a Thanksgiving. I never had Christmas because our job is to be there to be entertaining people for when they don't have to work. That's our mission. And so there were times when my whole family would be having Thanksgiving and I couldn't go because I was working and grateful, very, very grateful to have the job. So, and I can't think of very many things that were negatives about my years on Broadway. It all was plus. It just all was plus.
Well, that's great. Well, it sounds like kind of like almost like a bittersweet situation. Like you said, you get to make those lifelong friends, but then again, the industry, the way that it works out, you have to work when everybody else is not working. So yeah. It brings you guys closer together because you're together probably during those holidays and those other off times, I'm sure.
That's right. That's right. That's a very good point.
So yeah, no, that's awesome. And then, so do you have any like particular performances from any of the shows that like you just kind of always look back on, like for any particular reason?
You mean like from the Broadway shows?
Yeah.
Let me think. Well, you know, there are my first. I understudied in Promises, which was a show that was written by Neil Simon and Burt Bacharach and Hal David. And I was an understudy for the leading lady for quite a while before I had a chance to go on. And I was a pit singer. I sang backup from the orchestra pit with three other women. So I had a great experience of understudying a role on the stage, but really being a part of the band as well. So I had double experience. And I came to work one day. I went across the street. I got a tuna fish sandwich. I'm eating my sandwich before matinee day. And the stage manager comes downstairs and he says, "You're on." I went, I've got tuna fish in my teeth. I said, "I'm what?" He said, "You're on. Jill is sick. You're going on today, like in an hour." I was like, "Oh my God." So that was such a huge event for me, you know, calling the family, who could get here, who could get to the city to come see my show. And it just was so incredibly, incredibly exciting that one really stands out after all the many hundreds and hundreds of performances I've done. There's something about that first time you get to do your show on Broadway that is, beyond words.
No, that definitely sounds very memorable. Something that, like with most things, you for things that you have certain expectations for that don't live up to it, but then something just out of the blue happens and it just blows your mind, and it's just one of those lifelong memorable experiences, mm-hmm. just like that. So yeah. that's amazing. That's awesome. So that's a great one to have for sure. So then after some Broadway, you began your television career in the late 70s, appearing in some of the most iconic shows we talked about, with like Laverne and Shirley, Mork and Mindy, Three's Company, St. Elsewhere, I mean plenty more, before landing your major role in Mr. Belvedere. Were you a fan of any of these shows before you landed roles on them?
Oh, of course. My God. In fact, we moved, my husband and I moved to LA because his name is Ben Lanzaroni, he was offered the opportunity to write, he's a composer, to write music for Happy Days. So that's why we moved out. So we knew those shows really, really well and loved them. And I mean, it's incredible to guest on a show, to show up for a show, and there's all these people that you've been watching for years on TV and loving them and loving their show and loving their work, and they just accept you as one of them. It's like, oh my God, you guys, don't you realize how excited I am? And of course, you don't want to be uncool, so you don't do that. But, you know, your little kid inside of you is just jumping up and down and doing a happy dance.
Oh, sure. It's a fine line, like you said. You can't go fan kid on them, but you're just right. Inside. You're just like you're playing make believe in real life, basically. It's just got to be such a surreal situation to go from watching the show to being on it. So I'm sure it was something an out of body experience, like some people would probably say. What are some experience you learned, some experience that maybe you learned from being on these sets, or stories from some of these sets that you may utilize today, or just some good stories?
One of the most remarkable on-set experiences was doing Mork and Mindy, I would say. I did three episodes of Mork and Mindy, a standalone and a two-parter that was a season. It wasn't a season finale. It was almost a season finale, this two-parter. And the experience of being on the set with Robin Williams and Jonathan Winters is something that I'll never forget. And because they, two comic geniuses of two different eras who worked off of each other like nothing I'd ever seen before, it was fascinating to see these two comic masters just ping-ponging ideas and bits and line readings and stuff off of each other, and just laughing so hard and saying to myself, pay attention to what these guys are doing, because there's nobody as good as they are, and their attention to detail and their specificity in their comedy. So it was not only a great experience as a performer, but as a student, it was, I think, extraordinary.
Well, you couldn't have said it better. Like, you're learning from the best. I mean, Robin Williams, like, this is Robin Williams before Robin Williams, but he was still Robin Williams at the time.
Absolutely. And I'd seen Robin Williams in comedy clubs before he was even Robin Williams. So I'd been following him for years. So it was really exciting, and such a doll, such a sweet, sweet guy, and such a great acting partner, just there for you 100%. You know, he was so well trained as an actor that he was just right there with you, and charming and delightful, and really a special experience.
You might have walked by him in the New York streets, because he was always performing out there, yep. doing his mime work and stuff like that. So you might have walked by him, you not even yep. know it.
Absolutely.
So yeah, well, like you said, learning from those guys, their improv skills probably helped you with your next role back in 1985. You landed the role of Marsha Cameron Owens on this TV sitcom, Mr. Belvedere.
Streets on the China, never met her before. Who cares when you drop kicked your jacket as you came through the door? No one glared, but sometimes things get turned around and no one spared. All hands look out below. There's a change in the status quo. Gonna need all the help that we can get. According to our new arrival, life is more than mere survival. we just might live the good life yet.
Starring along with Bob Uecker as George Owens and Christopher Michael Hewitt as the posh butler Mr. Belvedere with kids Kevin and Heather, played by Rob Stone and Tracy Wells, ran for 117 episodes and 6 seasons from 1985 to 1990 during prime time on ABC Network.
The only one you missed was Bryce Beckham as Wesley.
Hey, you know, that's the magic of editing, I guess.
Yes, indeed.
So what were your initial thoughts, I guess, reading a premise for this show with a, you know, wholesome American family that happens to have this live-in butler at their service?
I thought it was really funny. And I've been a fan of the movies for years and was very excited to see that this was a TV show based on these Clifton Webb movies that I just loved. And when I first got the script and my husband and I read it, and he said to me, this is yours. This is your part. Don't even worry about it. Just go in there and tell them, you know, you'll walk in there and it's going to be yours. Don't even worry about it. And sometimes you just have a good match between an actor and a part. And I think that that's what happened with me and that show. The chemistry at the auditions, when, you know, you go through a couple of auditions before you get your final audition in front of network. And that's when you read with the other actors who have been cast. And that's where they see if you've got chemistry, what, you know, if you work well with the other people. And when I saw that it was that Christopher Hewitt was there, he was somebody that I'd known in New York and worked with. He directed me in a musical. And we had a long relationship before Mr. Belvedere. And when I met Bob Uecker, I said, we just hit it off like from the first minute, from the first second. We just had so much fun together. I've just felt like this is mine. This, my husband was right. This is my show. I'm going to do this and it's going to be wonderful. And that's basically what happened.
Yeah. And like you mentioned, the audition process, I've heard multiple times that for any primetime, you know, or like with ABC or any of those networks, you know, you have to go test in front of the executives. Is that right? Was that one of the more nerve-wracking auditions?
Yes and no. Let me tell you, it was, it might have been more nerve-wracking if my original audition and callback went really, really well. So I was feeling really good about it. And you're nervous when you get there, of course, because there's other people there who want the role as badly as you do. And everybody's talented. Everybody's good. It has, at that level, it has nothing to do with how good you are. It just has to do with who they think is going to be the best fit for what they want to do. And my nerves just disappeared when I went in and started reading with Bob Uecker. The chemistry was there immediately and I just relaxed and enjoyed him and he enjoyed me. So that's when the nerves left, was during the actual work of the audition. And it did the trick.
Well, that's awesome. Well, it's all about the chemistry. That's the main thing that they're looking for, on top of, like you said, skill-wise. But you already had that. It's all based on that chemistry, which and when you think about it, it's one of those things. Now you look back, like how much of a long shot it is and how many people they've looked at and tested, which is really a testament to, of course, talents and chemistry. So so when you landed the role and you start getting into the production of the show, what were like the major differences when preparing and acting on a sitcom compared to like the stage?
Well, every week it's new, which is fantastic. When you're in a long-running show, you're doing the same material 8 shows a week for years sometimes. And although every audience is new, it's still the same songs. It's the same lines for hundreds and hundreds of performances. Going into TV, it's so refreshing, and I felt it very refreshing that we had one script. We were going to do it for 1 week. Then it was over. Then we're going to do the next one. Then we're going to do the next one. So that's a huge difference and a welcome difference. I enjoyed that. The other difference, of course, is that you can stop if you make a mistake and you can do it over.
Get a couple mulligans in there.
Yeah, you can make a mistake. Nobody gets mad at you. You stop. You can do it over. You start from the beginning if you have to. And on stage, you don't do that. If you make a mistake, you barrel through. You fix your mistake as you're going. So there's something very luxurious about that. And the thing that's similar is when you come from stage and move into a multi-camera comedy, the skill set is not all that different because you're working for a live studio audience. You're putting on a show. You're not making a movie, which is a very different process. So I felt pretty comfortable moving from stage into TV. And once I got to Mr. Belvedere, I'd done a lot of television before Mr. Belvedere came along. And then when it's your show, you have the added luxury of it being your show. And you have a little more ownership. And you're treated really well and everybody respects you. So so that's really lovely.
You get that a different perspective because you've been on so many shows working with other actors who are kind of getting into their prime of the show. They've had time to get into it and get into the rhythm of it. And now you have your own show, you know, 117 episodes. You guys had plenty of time to hit your stride. And yes, it was and the show was amazing on primetime ABC network, which back in the day, I mean, you guys were getting tons of viewership. So I can imagine, you know, you like you said, you're getting some of the you know, admiration from everybody and just trying to maintain those expectations. I'm sure it had its balance of pros and cons as well.
Well, the thing that's the most nerve-wracking are ratings. So every Wednesday morning back then, we would look at the newspaper because that's where the ratings were. I didn't get a special call from anybody telling us how we did the previous week. So every Wednesday morning, it was coming downstairs looking at the paper to see how we did. And that was the hardest part about doing the show, was wanting to be accepted, wanting people to watch the show. If people watched the show, then we would be renewed. If they weren't watching the show, then we wouldn't be renewed. And we loved it so much, and it was so great having a steady job, that waiting for the ratings every week was, that was the nerve-wracking part.
Oh, I'm sure. And that's, I mean, they depict that all the time when they do these type of like reality TV, like, or not reality TV, but depict what it's like to be on a show. It's always like people are worried about those ratings. Yep. That's the end all be all. So I can't even imagine. Yep. So, but you know, you guys being together that long, six seasons, I'm sure you've became really close. You probably, you know, roller coaster of emotions like it is with anybody who spends that much time with each other, but I'm sure you probably stay in touch with most of the cast. Is that correct?
Absolutely. Again, I feel, although I don't see them all the time, I feel very, very close to them. And I know that they would do anything for me if I needed them. They know I would do anything for them if they needed me. You form a very special bond, especially when you play the parent to children, even though they, you know, now they're all grown up and they have kids of their own. I still feel pretty possessive about them. And we had a really nice party a year ago, June, here at my house, where we had like 40 people from Mr. Belvedere come. Unfortunately, Bob Uecker couldn't come. He was doing baseball in another town, so he wasn't able to come. But we had everybody from props to wardrobe to writers and producers and directors all came, and the cast, of course, all came. And we just were so happy to see each other and be in each other's company again. And we recognize what a special thing we had and how grateful we are to have had that experience for so long.
Well, that's great that you guys, like you said, keep in touch with the power of social media. It's easier to keep updated. You don't, like you said, not necessarily have to see them face to face, but at least get to know how them and their families are doing. So that's always, you know, a positive thing for sure.
Yes, it is. And we can be each other's cheerleader. I mean, Tracy Wells, who played Heather, is a very successful real estate agent here in L.A., and, you know, she sells lots and lots of houses. And whenever she sells something, it's like we all post on Facebook, yay, my little girl is doing so well. And, you know, all of that stuff. And it doesn't annoy her. So I'm happy about that.
Well, that's great. You guys still have that kind of connection.
Yeah, it is.
Well, like I said, we're talking about your work on Mr. Belvedere. Kind of want to get into a little bit right after that. 1992, you co-starred with Rodney Dangerfield as his girlfriend slash soon-to-be wife, Bess, with her son Matthew, played by the late Jonathan Brandis in the 90s classic Ladybugs, a movie about a salesman conning his way into a promotion and a marriage by coaching his company's girls' soccer team to championship by secretly dressing his girlfriend's son in drag. And shenanigans ensue.
Shenanigans ensue.
To get ahead in business.
Good luck.
Thanks. Oh, and I'm glad you gave me the right figure.
Sometimes you have to play ball.
Chester, my company sponsors a girls' soccer team.
I'm coaching the Ladybugs. It sort of goes with the promotion, you know?
You cut the ball down the field into the net. Try and control the ball. Forget the ball. Try and stay on your feet. Oh, I'm off to a great start.
What he's willing to try.
What?
Could get him arrested.
No, you're crazy, Chester. It'll never happen.
Chester put a boy on a girl's soccer team.
Don't worry, if it's too tight, you'll get used to it.
Yeah.
So another one that I'm sure once you picked up the script, you're just kind of like, you know, I think this is for me. I think you have a knack for these off-the-wall type of premises.
It was so silly. It was so incredibly silly, Ladybugs. We shot it in Denver, and
I didn't really know that until I was watching the opening, because I rewatched it just recently. Oh. And I literally realized the opening scene. I'm like, the Brown Palace. I've actually gone in there and ate restaurant at the restaurant. So it blew me away.
Oh, there we were. You know, it was really madcap comedy, almost slapstick comedy, which is always so much fun to do. And apparently, it was one of the first, if not the first, movie that included girls soccer. And it was extremely popular with young girls who were playing sports. You know, I had tons of girls coming up to me saying, it's the first time I ever saw girls doing on screen what I love to do. And it made me feel so good. And all of that. I said, well, that's just fantastic, you know, to be able to stake that claim that we were able to bring girls in sports onto the screen, something that really hadn't been done very much before.
Yeah, not only girls, but boys. I mean, I was like in second or third grade when this movie came out, and I was like, you know, in the whole mix of, you know, the kids' sports and stuff like that. So Ladybugs was definitely in my rotation of summer movies that were, you know, when you're at home, mom's at work, well, I'm watching me some Ladybugs for sure. And yeah, you're right. It did inspire. I had girlfriends who definitely were inspired by, you know, just the movie itself. My wife and I, who are huge fans, she was Penny Pester the other year. And I was Matthew, so we dressed up as Halloween as Ladybugs.
Oh my god, that's hilarious.
Yeah, we had a few, we were taking our nieces and nephews trick-or-treating, and so we had a few moms recognize, like, wait a second, are you the Ladybugs? So the dream's still alive out there for the Ladybugs. So yeah, like I said, you guys, you shot in Denver. I guess the whole Rocky Mountain soccer thing just went over my head as a kid, but now myself living in Denver, it's the extra cool factor.
I see. Well, yeah, Denver's nice. I loved that mall. What was that mall, like the Cherry Creek Mall?
Oh yes,
is that a place?
It still is.
It's still a place. And I would have to like ration my visits to the mall because I was spending all of my salary.
It's very easy. Very easy there.
It was so nice. And it was a really nice place to shoot. Although there were so many thunderstorms that like every day it would rain. So it would be like, what are we shooting? We were supposed to be shooting outside. Now we're shooting inside. So there were some tricky moments because of shooting in Denver, but mostly it was beautiful.
What were some of the other cool things you did while you're in town? Were you able to go hiking or anything like that?
No, you know, this was like before everybody had cell phones and everything. So I always had to be on call. So I really didn't get to do a whole lot of things because I never knew when they were going to call me and say, it's raining, you have to come because now we're going to do the kitchen scene instead of a soccer scene. So I didn't do a whole lot. What was fun was just being able to walk outside and try different restaurants and oh, that bookstore. There's that tattered
cover. Yeah.
Oh my
wife and I still buy books from there. We bought one the other day.
Just a phenomenal bookstore. So whenever I would have some time off, I would just get and hop in the car and go down to that bookstore. It was really a great place.
Well, it's awesome. Yeah, well, maybe we'll have to have like a Mr. Belvedere reunion or something here in Denver so you have a chance to come out here and get some of the extra activities in.
That would be fun.
So we'll have to get something lined up. So other things, too, you worked with, of course, with the comedian Rodney Dangerfield, who come off one cult classic from Caddyshack, Back to School, and now Ladybugs. So were some, you know, I feel like he's like another Robin Williams, like he's always on. So like sort of some crazy stories about Rodney at all?
Well, I don't know that there's crazy stories about Rodney, but Rodney, he's serious. He's a serious guy. He was a very serious man, serious about his comedy, serious about life. And yet, you know, we would have downtime in between scenes and I would say, tell me about when you used to sell windows. And he was always more than willing to engage and to tell me stories about his life. But the thing that I found most impressive about Rodney was his ability to write on the spot. We'd be in the middle of a scene and one of the other writers was his partner Harry. I can't remember Harry's last name right now, who wrote the movie. So we'd be in the middle of a scene and everybody would feel like, it just needed a little something extra. And they'd say, Rodney, we need a few different lines. I need a joke here. And Rodney on the spot could come up with 5-6 jokes that would work in the scene. And they would just be able to pick one. I say, my God, how do you do that? He says, that's what I do. That's my job. So as someone who is not organic, I can't do that. I can't think of funny lines. I can't make up a joke to save my life. To watch him be able to just do that on the spot was, wow, it was really remarkable.
And to think that all had been like just kind of harvesting for years. Like when he's telling you about the window stuff, that was just a few years earlier. Like a lot of people don't know that Rodney got started real late, you know, mm-hmm. in regards to comedy and then into acting yep. and stuff like that. So mm-hmm. I can imagine what having Rodney Dangerfield as your actual window salesman would be like.
I wonder. Oh my God. I can't imagine.
And the other actor you worked with the late Jonathan Brandis, who's a favorite actor of mine growing up. Like he was in, of course, Neverending Story, It, Ladybugs, and my personal favorite Sidekicks. Like I just grew up like just absolutely wanting to be him in that movie, and it was just devastating, of course, of his passing in 2003. So like what was it like working with him too, as you know, being another, you know, mom figure, mentor figure to another actor?
Jonathan was really, really smart, and he was a real student of film. He knew every movie, who directed every movie, who shot every movie. He was a real student of film and film history. And he just blew me away all the time with the breadth and depth of his knowledge, and a charming, sweet, wonderful guy with a wonderful family. I'm getting a red signal. Are you there?
Yes, I'm still here, sir. Oh,
okay, I just got a real strange signal on my computer. And maybe it's Jonathan saying hi to us.
Maybe.
And it was devastating to get the call that he had taken his life. And I knew his mom and dad. I got to be very friendly with his mom and dad while we were shooting the film because they were there all the time. And it's something I don't know that you can ever get over, is losing someone like that. And you know, today actually I think is Suicide Prevention Day.
It is.
And if there's anything anybody could have done, his friends were there for him. Everybody was there for him. But it was just a depression that he couldn't handle. And such a sweet, talented guy with an unlimited future. It was absolutely heartbreaking. It was horrible.
It was. I mean, even somebody from a distance who didn't know him personally at all, it was devastating because I had felt like I'd grown to know him through the movies, through his acting. I was just like, man, this, you know, I wanted to be him in all these movies. And then, like, it was just one of those first deaths as a kid when you hear about an actor that really, like, as a kid, you're like, wow, that, like, it I can feel this one. Normally you hear them, you're like, I feel bad, but with when I heard him, it was one of the first ones I remember just being like, really, like, I felt it hurt. So yeah, yeah. I mean, like you said, with Suicide Prevention Day, maybe we can have a dedication to Jonathan in that regard, you know, to spread more awareness, you know, because there's always that what if. People are always thinking that what if. People shouldn't, because it is tough. You can do all right. You can to help somebody, but sometimes, yeah, like you said, the depression can take over.
Yeah, it can. And you know, I'm still in touch with his mom, and they're doing okay, and they're wonderful people, and you know, they're moving on with their life, which is great.
Well, good. Well, he'll always be remembered for these, you know, awesome roles that he was in with these cult classics like Ladybugs and the Neverending Story. So he's, and of course for me, Sidekicks. Like, his memory will live on forever for sure. So we'll make sure we keep it a positive memory forever for sure for Jonathan.
Thank you.
Yes, of course. And so the last thing before we end the podcast, you've also been busy with other talents of like publishing a book, releasing music, singing for other many productions, as well as creating a vocal performance workshop. So to say you're busy is to say the least. So first of all, how'd you get involved in writing the book, which has a very lengthy but efficient title, What the Other Mothers Know, A Practical Guide to Child Rearing, told in a really nice, funny way that won't make you feel like a complete idiot the way all those other parenting books do, end quote.
Well, my friend, very good friend, Donna Rosenstein, who is a casting director, she's now head of casting for Amazon. We were both just two moms in show business, and we didn't know a lot of the things that everybody else seemed to know about, like little tricks and helpful hints that, you know, we didn't know that stuff that people who grew up thinking, I'm going to be a parent and I'm going to be the best and I'm going to know where to get the hamburgers and I'm going to know how to bring cupcakes and I'm going to know about field trips. We knew nothing about that. And one day she said to me, How do they know that? And said, what? I wish I knew what the other mothers know. And we looked at each other and we said, that's a book. So we got in touch with another writer, Michelle Gendelman, who was a very successful TV writer. And we put our heads together and made this book. And it was really a lot of fun to do. We had focus groups. We met with a lot of moms who were very, very much, much smarter than we were. And we wanted it to be funny and to have a light touch. And I think we succeeded.
I think I have my my forever gift to new parents, my new parent friends. I'll be sending this to them for sure. So, yeah, so we'll have to send some, we'll get some links.
The thing to send to your new parent friends is our Grammy-nominated CD called Baby's Broadway Lullabies.
Yes, I wanted to get into that as well. The nomination back in the 2003, is that correct?
Right. That's right. But we still sell them. We're downloaded all the time. You know, people don't buy CDs anymore, really. But we get downloaded, and I still get orders. And you know, it's a classic. It's Broadway show tunes all arranged as lullabies. And it brought together my two favorite things, which was music from Broadway and being a mom, and of course singing. And it's really a beautiful CD, and it's a great first parent gift. It really lulls everybody to sleep. I just tell people, don't play it in the car. Very important when you're driving. Don't play the CD while you're driving.
You could put everybody to sleep.
In the best possible way.
Yes, exactly. The best possible way.
Not from boredom.
No. But and then so it sounds like you could put a care package bundled together for new parents with the CDs and with the book. You need one more aspect. You got a perfect bundle package.
Yes, maybe I'll crochet them blankets or something. I don't know.
Perfect. That's all you needed. That was the missing link right there. So yeah, we'll definitely get the links in for that. And just real quick, some other things. Of course, you've been performing still. You know, some other productions. What are some other productions you've been doing recently?
Well, the last thing we did, our daughter is also a musical theater performer, and she lives in New York, Nika Graff Lanzaroni. And we were approached by this fabulous club in New York, cabaret club called 54 Below, Feinstein's 54 Below, that Michael Feinstein is part owner of. And they asked us if we would do a concert together, a duet concert. She has done many concerts by herself. I have done many concerts by myself, but we've never done anything together. So that's the last thing that we did. We put together a show for 54 Below that we just did it in July. And it was a huge success. And we're going to be bringing it to L.A. We're just nailing down the details of an engagement here in L.A. And it was just, you know, a dream come true to be able to work with your kid and to watch, you know, I'm sure your parents feel this way, you know, to watch your kid become self-sustaining and responsible and talented and good at business and all that stuff. We really had a blast.
No, that sounds like it's going to be a great opportunity. We'll have to get some links as well, so when you guys have that posted up or when the performance is up, so people can check that out.
Thank you. That would be great. I appreciate it.
Yeah, no problem. And then lastly, too, you had opened created a vocal performance workshop. Is that something you're still involved with as well?
Yes. First class of this session is this Saturday.
Oh, okay.
Excited. Yeah. It's like an 8, 9, 10-week session, depending on how many weeks we have available. And we teach vocal performance, how people can improve their singing performance, how to connect with an audience, how to act a lyric, how to be a healthy singer. And I find great satisfaction in sharing my many, many, many years of experience with other singers and helping them to get better.
Now, is this all in person, or do you do videos or like online type of stuff?
It is an in-person workshop. We have a class full of people who all want to come once a week and take a class.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
We'll throw the link down there for that one as well. We'll have a few links for people to check out for the book, for the CDs, and also for the vocal performance workshop.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So well, Ilene, that was everything I wanted to go over. I appreciate you, you know, sticking around for the extra time, you know, and taking the time today to be a guest. Let the listeners know where they can follow you on social media to keep updated.
I am IleneGraff.com. I'm on Facebook. I am a Neanderthal. I don't do Instagram. My daughter keeps saying, Ma, you got to be on Instagram. I said, I know. Would you do it for me? She says, no, you're a grown up. You have to learn how to do these things for yourself.
It's like the opposite now. We're trying to get you to learn things.
Yes. You know, she's everywhere and I'm kind of nowhere. But on Twitter, Ilene Graff. And yeah, that's it.
Well, perfect. Like I said, we'll get all the links down there below so everyone can come check out everything that we talked about today. Again, thank you so much for taking the time. And thanks to everyone else for tuning into this episode of the Be Kind and Rewind podcast. Make sure you tune in every Throwback Thursdays for new episodes of the podcast. Subscribe, like, and follow and rate the podcast on all podcast apps, including iTunes, Spotify, iHeartRadio, YouTube, and SoundCloud, including Infirmary Media Podcast Network. Also, follow the podcast on social media on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Be Kind Rewind Pod for all your nostalgic needs. So thanks, and be excellent to each other.
And now, a word from
Infirmary Media.